With the latest on our hometown teams, this is Sports Wrap-Up with Bob Kuczynski on WBBZ-TV, your hometown television station. Now, from our studios at the Eastern Hills Mall, here is Bob Kuczynski.
And good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to Sports Wrap-Up. Busy sports day, especially concerning the Buffalo Sabres. My guest in studio will be Steve Manson, the hockey man. And why? Because we're going to talk about the Buffalo Sabres naming Ron Rolston as their permanent head coach. Permanent as in he was the interim head coach. Of course, he took over for Lindy Ruff. And Darcy Regier made that announcement today at a news conference. And Steve Matz will be here to talk about Ron Rolston, who is known to be a teacher. And the fact that the Sabres are going to be a very young team, that's what they tell us. I guess it's appropriate they would have a teacher at the helm. So Rolston named the new head coach out at the Sabres. UB has a new head wrestling coach, and his name is John Stutzman. John Stutzman is a UB alum. He was the winningest wrestler at UB when he left in 1998. He's been down at Bloomsburg, where he's had quite a career, and he will be named as a new wrestling coach out at UB. And speaking of which, Danny White, the athletic director, had a chance to talk to Danny a little while ago. Danny's got high hopes for the UB athletic program.
Yeah, you know, our goal is to create a national brand for this university. We are New York's big public university, and to do that, we got to become more relevant locally, and even amongst our alumni base locally and certainly our community. So we realized pretty quickly in the course of the last several months that we got to shake some things up, do some things differently, get a little more aggressive in our approach, and so that means sometimes making difficult decisions with coaching changes, which we have, but also we'll be rolling out a much more aggressive marketing and branding campaign locally and across the state and into New York City.
Everything in this state is about funds, your state institution. You feel you have the resources to do what you want to do?
We do. I think the university has stepped up over the last several years in supporting 1A athletics and ultimately getting us competitive. But what we talk about all the time with our coaches and staff is we should be operating with a sense of urgency. This university needs to see a return on that investment, the student support that we get. And so we are operating with that sense of urgency that drives us every day to ultimately bring, you know, bowl caliber football programs, NCAA tournament caliber basketball programs, men and women, championships across the board with all of our programs.
I think it's going to be an exciting time out at UB. Let's shift gears. Buffalo Bisons are in action tonight, 7 o'clock. They'll be hosting the Norfolk Tides. They are two games in front of Scranton, the Yankees affiliate, in first place. Taking a look at the standings there, the Bisons off to a really good start and two games up on the Rail Riders. New York Yankees, the next game on WBBZ, next Friday, the 17th, 7 o'clock. That'll be your next opportunity to win the WBBZ Man Cave. And what's the Man Cave? It's an HD projector, an Xbox 360, a DVD player, iPod dock. It's an all-inclusive entertainment center. I'd love to have one in my living room. You have a chance to win. Just watch the Yankee game, wait for the clue, and then email WBBZ.TV, and you could have a chance to win at the end of the month. Coming up, Steve Manson, the hockey man, right after this on Sports Wrap-Up. And welcome back to Sports Wrap-Up. Bob Kuczynski with the hockey man, Steve Manson, in studio because he's here to discuss the fact that the Buffalo Sabres have made interim head coach Ron Rolston the head coach.
They certainly have. It's not a huge surprise, but I'm going to tell you, I'm disappointed. Mainly what I'm disappointed about is the fact they didn't do a coaching search. I heard an interview with Darcy Regier this morning who said that, you know, they pretty much thought that Rolston was their guy and they didn't go out and do the search. There's only 30 NHL head coaching jobs in, you know, available. You mean to tell me that Ron Rolston was the best candidate for that job? I know they want to have a teacher, and I know Rolston, that's his claim to fame, and, you know, and they're going to be younger next year and the whole bit. I just don't buy it. There's so many great young candidates out there, and I'm biased. I will admit this. I come out, you know, I worked for many, many years in the Ontario Hockey League. I come out of Canadian Junior Hockey. there's just so many good young Canadian junior hockey coaches available that at least should have gotten an interview. And there's even some guys that aren't young. A guy like a Dale Hawerchuk, who is coaching the Barry Colts. He's got them in the finals. In fact, they're ahead in the finals at this point. Is being rumored as a possible candidate for the Winnipeg job, possibly in Calgary, possibly in Colorado. And he doesn't even deserve to get an interview. Now, I know you can't interview him until the season's over. Well, the season in for him, is other than going to the Memorial Cup, is going to be over another week or so, and they could have interviewed him then. I mean, it just seems to me, what was the rush? You know, unless they had already decided, and if that was the case, why didn't they do it last week when they spilled out all the other bad news? This is not going to excite the fan base. And once again, this is a team that has cried out for several years now for change, and what we're getting is just status quo. I'm surprised. I'm shocked.
Well, you established the last time you were on the show, you were never a huge fan of Ryan Rolston to begin with, because he comes from the USA,
the USA Hockey program, which I'm not, you know, again, I'm a Canadian junior guy. I just believe that it's a better approach, a better way of doing it. It's not that USA Hockey's wrong. It's just different, okay? And I just don't buy that Ron Rolston is the guy.
Well, when Lindy Ruff was fired, the Sabres were in 11th place. They ended the season in 11th place.
Right.
Ron Rolston had
15, 11, and 5.
And 8 of those were regulation wins, right, and the rest were shootout wins.
Shootouts, because the overtimes would have counted as what they call the ROW number.
Now, obviously, they had made this decision last week.
Yep.
I mean, there was no search done in the last week.
That's what they admitted this morning.
And maybe because their news conference was terse enough, they didn't want to throw that in there. I mean, that news conference, people are still buzzing about what happened last week.
Oh, absolutely. One of the most cantankerous news conferences you've been around a lot longer than I have.
I haven't been around longer than you. You just admitted that you were an intern for Stan Barron in the 60s.
Okay.
I haven't been around longer than you. I
tried to get away with that one. I have never seen anything like that. The news tried to come in with an agenda. There's no doubt about that. But the Sabres, their answers, some of them just weren't even true. I mean, I would say it right bold-faced. I mean, they kept talking about, well, we raised ticket prices 4%. Well, 2% goes to the players and only 2% goes to our bottom line. Wait a second. Didn't we just have a lockout in which the players' share went from 57% to 50%? So isn't that 7% going to your bottom line? So right away we're talking about 9% going to your bottom line. Where was that mentioned? Nowhere. I mean, this whole thing is ridiculous. And the fact that Ted Black lost is cool. I mean, you cannot, president of a team, you just can't do that.
Well, first off, and I heard Jerry Sullivan. Jerry Sullivan thinks that Ted Black purposely took on the media because he wanted to divert attention away from the Darcy Regier retention.
Right.
I don't believe that to be true. I don't think you can go into a news conference waiting to jump on media. I mean, I guess you can, but I don't believe that's their strategy. I do think, however, when Jerry Sullivan made the remark, I've already written my article for tomorrow, for whatever reason, that kind of set Ted Black off. But you're right. Ted Black was disingenuous in saying that Terry Pegula is available for
comment. Exactly. That was going to be my next point. The point is, the very first thing that Ted Black said in the start of the news conference, I'm not Darcy Regier's boss, because everybody was asking the question, why did you retain Darcy Regier?
Have you ever heard of that before?
I have never heard of that.
Is not
never
the
heard
boss
of, that.
Of the general manager?
Obviously, I've heard of it now. Well, if that's the case, the guy, obviously, who decided to keep Darcy Regier was Terry Pegula, because who's Ted Black's boss? Okay, who makes the final decisions? And the fact that Pegula was not made available at that time, it was wrong, because, yes, this entire community, the media, the fan base, everybody wanted to know, why are the Sabres heading in this direction? Well, it turns out the only one that can really answer that is Terry Pegula. And obviously, Terry Pegula is not available. And then they said, oh, we just made him available 3 weeks ago when we had the Webster Block thing. Well, the moment hockey questions started coming up at that press conference, they skewered him right off the podium. I mean, you know, here's a guy, and I have a lot of respect for Mr. Pegula. I feel what he's done down there is fantastic. The building of that new building is going to be great. The improvements to the arena. But the only thing I really care about, and I think the only thing 90% of the people really care about, is what goes on the ice. Okay? This town craves just a team that's contending, not just, you know, they want to win a cup. But, I mean, I was there the very first game between Montreal and Buffalo. I've been there for 40-odd years. What is it, 43 now or whatever? I have not seen a Stanley Cup championship. I'd like to see one in my lifetime, and that's starting to run out here.
Well, certainly it's not hockey heaven right now.
No, it's just the opposite. You have to ask yourself, what is this team doing? I mean, they talk about they have to do more suffering. They have to bring in all these young guys. Why? Look at Montreal. Montreal had a worse record than we did last year. They made a few changes, including changing the general manager and coach. They made a few changes on the ice and everything, and here they are. They won the division, or... they didn't win the division, but they're in the playoffs, and you know, and they're competing, and it's, yeah, they did win the division. I knew I got that right. It doesn't take that long to turn it around in hockey because young players is the lifeblood of the NHL. You bring in young players, the Sabres certainly have a lot of draft choices, a lot of young prospects and everything. It doesn't take that long to turn it around if the right guy's calling the shots. And right now, I don't have the confidence in Darcy Rikar.
All right, Steve, sit right there. We're going to take a break. More to come. More from Steve Matson, the Hockey Man, right after this on Sports Wrap-Up. Welcome back to Sports Wrap-Up. We have a very agitated hockey man. Steve Matson is here. Steve, there's a couple behind-the-scenes people involved with the Sabres that you don't hear too much of. They're there, but they're not the gentlemen who come out at the news conferences.
No, and you know, every owner, everybody has advisors, and it's certainly not unusual. Ken Sawyer is his advisor. He has a background with the Pittsburgh Penguins and everything, and he supposedly is the guy that advises Terry Pegula, and, you know, it's just... again, the buck stops with Terry Pegula. And I really think he owes it to the fans, not to the media, but he owes it to the fans to explain why this team is staying status quo. And I don't think I don't think it's that much to ask.
Well, what's really mystifying to me is when he bought the team, this team was on the verge of breaking out to the upper echelon.
Yes.
They had started out slow that year. They caught fire. They should have beaten the Flyers in the playoffs. They had them down 3-2. Mm-hmm. Miller was playing unbelievable. The Flyers came back and won that series.
Yep.
And the Sabres never seemed to have recovered since. They did some big signings in the offseason that year.
Mm-hmm.
Why did this team go south instead of climbing the ladder?
Well, it's a good question. It's hard to answer. They've never really been solid up the middle. I really thought their acquisition of Hotson and moving Ennis to the middle would help considerably, and it didn't. They really still need that big guy up the middle, and I think that's what they were lacking back then. Plus the fact, the trading of Paul Gostad. I know everybody heralds that as, oh, what a fantastic move. You got a first-round pick for him and a whole bit, and that may turn out to be a great thing down the road. But the bottom line is, what they did, they traded away their top defensive center. They traded away their best faceoff man. And last year, when they came up just short of making the playoffs, I guarantee you, if they had kept Gosshead on that team for the remaining 28 days of the season for, I think there was 16 games or whatever, they definitely would have won a couple of those at least, and they would have been in the playoffs. And this thing about, well, you don't want to make the playoffs as the eighth seed, well, eighth seeds do very well, including winning the Stanley Cup last year. It's about getting in and then worrying about it. And Lindy Ruff was always a tremendous playoff coach. I think that was probably his best thing he had going for him.
Do you think Miller and Vanek will be here next year when the season starts?
Boy, that's a tough question. I honestly don't know. I go both ways on it. Here's the thing. If you're totally tearing the thing apart, then you should move them because you're going to get more for them this summer than you will next year at the trade deadline. And, you know, and you're not going to re-sign them. But if you think you eat one or the other or both are part of your future, then, of course, you've got to go out and re-sign them. I mean, goaltenders don't get that kind of money.
I think Ryan Miller wants out.
It sure does look that way, doesn't it? The way he acted at the last game of the year and the whole bit, and I'm not saying he acted improperly. I think it's just that he was like
well,
a guy saying
why would he want to stay? If they announce that you're going to go through a lot of suffering, why would either Vanek or Miller, I mean, granted, they're both making a lot of money, and they have homes here, whatever. I think Miller put his condo up for sale.
Two separate things here. Miller, they're not going to get a lot for him. Whoever they get, whatever they get from Miller, fans are going to scream and shout. And the reason you're not going to get it, he's an outstanding goaltender. There's no doubt about it. But he doesn't have the cup. He doesn't have – he's got a Vezina, but he hasn't put up those fantastic numbers recently.
Well,
and he also makes more money than people want to pay
for goaltenders. Well, he makes a lot of money, but I think one of the teams who may lose too early in the playoffs – because their goaltending wasn't strong, they'd be a candidate for a guy like Ryan Miller, I think.
Well, yes, that's true, but you're going to have a number of goals. You're going to have either Roberto Luongo or Corey Snyder on the market if Vancouver loses out very quickly, which they're about to. You're going to have a number of goaltenders available, and teams have proven now, Chicago is a good example, you don't need a superstar, highly paid goaltender to win. What you really should do is take that money and invest it in defense and make your defense the best in the league and play it that way. And again, you just don't put that kind of money in goaltending anymore.
No. How much is Miller going to make next year? Do you remember?
A little bit over six.
A little over $6 million.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's not bad. Let's talk about the NHL playoffs. Okay. We've got a board here we're going to put up. Some surprises.
Oh, I think there's a lot of surprises. I think every one of the series, I think the Islanders are giving the Penguins everything they can handle. I mean, the Islanders almost beat them the other day, and they would have a 2-1 goal in the series. I think, let's talk about Montreal-Ottawa. I mean, just an absolute war the other night. And I hate this term, old-time hockey, because I'm old-time hockey. But that's the way it was. It was played. And then, of course, everybody's jumping on the league that with all the penalties and the fighting and everything, there was no disciplinary action. Well, guess what? Every single TV station in the country carried the highlights, even down in Alabama and Mississippi.
Well,
and places
what they carried was the injury.
Well, they carried the injuries. They carried the fighting. They carried everything, just the melee that went on. Tonight's game between the two teams are going to get huge rating for the NBC Sports Network. I mean, not just all hockey fans are going to be tuning in, but a lot of people are going to be tuning in because, it's going to be the retribution, the whole bit. It's what the National Hockey League wants. Let's, be honest.
Obviously, whether it's football, whether it's hockey, the fans want contact. They want physical play. You don't want to see guys carried off the ice or carried off the field. But you like to see good old, hard-hitting hockey.
Yep, the way the game was supposed to be played. Unfortunately, people get hurt. And, you see that in football. You see it in hockey.
Well, I think the NHL's got to go eventually to a much more secure, almost a more NFL-like headgear. A helmet, more like the collegiate ranks, I think, because there's just too many. The helmets aren't on. I don't believe they're on secure enough to protect you from all the high sticking.
A lot of the players have the thing dangling.
Right.
I've seen players, not recently, but I've seen them over the years, take some of the padding out so it's cooler up there and the whole bit. I couldn't agree with you more. I don't know why hockey players aren't wearing an NFL helmet.
I remember why the league was against it, because they wanted the fans to see the faces of the players. They want them to be able to recognize the players. The NFL doesn't have a problem with that.
No, I agree. It's ridiculous, especially in a fast-moving sport that, in the NHL plays 3-4 times a week compared to once for the NFL.
Just a couple minutes left here. I want to, first of all, let's give your website a plug.
Oh, you can get a hold of us and see the Western New York Hockey Magazine. You got to go to WNYHockeyNow.com. We have stories, including the story on Ron Rolston, breaking every single day on that site.
Oh, great. Now, we've only got a minute here, but you were talking off the air. You said and I mentioned earlier, you were an intern for Stan Barron?
Yes, I was. Back in the days when he was...
First of all, Stan Barron was like a legend, an icon at WBN Radio for years at night.
I hate the fact that you actually have to say that, because the man at his time was as big as they come. I was in for him long before he went to WBN. He was actually working for the Buffalo Bisons hockey team, and there was he was the play-by-play guy in the public relations. And I used to, during the games at the Odd, they had a stand set up right in the red seats where he would do his broadcast all by himself. There was no color man, no between the period guy, no highlight guy. do the entire broadcast himself, and I would be the guy that would run and get him stats or a Coke or even something stronger once in a while. And I just, I adored the man, just absolutely adored the man. And I think, you know, and later on when he was at WBN, I used to do some stuff for him.
Yeah, he used to do, what was the show called, Freeform Sports?
Yep.
Yeah, he'd play music, but in between he'd give scores, but he was really known for, especially for the high school teams.
Yep.
Because they could call in and he would
and
give
he
their results.
And he was on for 5.5 hours yeah. every night.
Not like these wimps today. You know, Howard Simon, 5 hours, please.
All
John
by
Murphy.
Himself.
John Murphy does 2 hours.
Yes, all by himself. And Murphy's the guy that replaced Stan.
Yeah, he did at WB,
so.
Yeah. Steve, thanks so much for
always
coming down. It was kind of short notice. We had a big hockey story today, but thanks for being on, and always a pleasure. We'll have you back before the playoffs are over.
Okay.
Steve Matson, the Hockey Man. We'll be back to wrap up Sports Wrap Up right after this.
Guests of Sports Wrap Up receive a gift certificate to dine at Ilia DiPaolo's restaurant and Ringside Lounge, 3785 South Park Avenue in Blaisdell.
And it's time to say goodnight. I want to thank Steve Manson. Next week, another Steve. Steve Tasker, Buffalo Bills legend, will be on to talk about his son Luke and other things going on with one of the best special teams player ever to play in the NFL. That's on next week's show. Until then, this is Bob Kuczynski saying have yourself a good night and a much better tomorrow.